never gonna let me down. No, you're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. 'Cause you are good, so good. Oh, and you are good, good. Oh, and you are good, so good. Oh, and you are good, so good. Oh, you are good, good. Holding on, even when the night is holding on to me, God is holding on, even when the night is holding on to me, I know my God is holding on. Yes, I know my God is holding on. My God is holding on. The secret place, just an altar in love. Love is found here in our sacred space. I hear your voice, I see your face. And you're still my just for you and me. Break the bread and pour the wine. Perfect union, nothing in between. I am yours and you are mine. 'Cause you're still my first. You're still my only one.
letters are being written to the churches. One of the churches that's told this: remember from which you have fallen. You've forsaken the love that you've had at first. So come back. Come back to the love that you once had. When you were first saved, when you were first welcomed into the kingdom, come back to that love. And I just really feel like that's what the Lord has for us, is to come back to that love. That love where we want to stand before Him and we want to worship Him because He's so worthy of it. That love that we had when we first came to know Jesus. That love that we had when we just got baptized and we're so excited to come out of the water and be so joyful. The Lord doesn't want a spirit of apathy from His people. The Lord wants a heart that says, Jesus, You're still my first love. So we're going to go into this next bridge and we're going to just ask the Lord to breathe on the embers in our hearts. That we would be on fire for the Lord. That we would have that first love that He desires that we have.
So breathe on the embers of my heart. Fan it into flame. And let it burn, let it burn. The end.
Of us, but you want all of us. Lord, we pray that in view of the love that you have for us, that we would love you. We pray that in view of the mercies that you poured out, that we would offer ourselves as a living sacrifice. Jesus, we thank you for the privilege of coming into your presence and praising you. We pray that as Chris comes up and he speaks, Lord, out of your word and the words that you've given him, Lord, that we would be convicted of things that we're due conviction of, that we'd be encouraged of encouragement that you want to give, Lord, that you transform our hearts by your word and by your presence, Lord. We love you in this place, Jesus. In your name, amen.
Father's Day, special day for Father's Day. title of the message today is Living in the New Man. So, because of what Christ has come and did on the cross to take our punishment and the wrath for the sin and the rebellion that we've lived, he came, put it to death, and that we could live his life and live the abundant life that he's called us to live. And so let's get into prayer and we'll get into the Word. Father, I thank you for bringing us all here this morning. And a special day just for fathers. Lord, I just ask a special blessing on all the fathers here today, Lord, that they would truly feel loved and that they are an integral, important part in their families, Father, and that they would know that they are truly loved and respected and honored. Lord, so I ask that you would pour a blessing upon all fathers today for the dedication, and that you'd show them just the care that you have for them. Father, and even as we gather in the Word today, that you would open up our eyes, give us wisdom and revelation, Father, that you would just take this life that I give you today, Lord, and that you just speak through me. That these would be your words, and this would be your heart for all of us today. That this would not just be words on a page, but this would point to you, Jesus. This would point to you, the living Jesus. Not just a book, not just a sense of principles. But Lord, that we would draw near to you today and we would find complete freedom in the life that you have for us. That any lies be broken off of our lives today. And that we would live in freedom. And that you would bring freedom through us, to others in this lost world. That we would be your lights on this world, on this earth. So Lord, open up your Word to us this morning. And show us how you'd have us to live. And how you'd have us to come together as the body of Christ. As you as the head, that we'd be one people, one new humanity, walking, living, breathing in you. So I ask that you breathe on this Word today. You open up our hearts, open up our minds to understand, enlighten our understanding. We thank you. In Jesus' name. Amen. So Colossians chapter 3. Started in today. And so we will be in the book of Colossians today for the most part of the day. And Colossians was a book that Paul wrote while he was in prison. And I've read many things. He either is in prison or he was in house arrest, one of the two. But nevertheless, he was under, he didn't have the freedom that he did in the natural. And Paul never met the Colossians. He never met them, but he, a fellow worker of his, Epaphras, actually went there and started the church, and Paul was asked, and so he wrote them the book of Colossians here. And the book of Colossians is pretty much Christ. It's not a whole lot of anything but bringing back to the centrality of our lives as believers, that our lives are categorized by Jesus Christ, that as we'll go on to see, that it's not categorized by the ways of this world, the principles of this world, the knowledge of this world, and even legalism, the do's and don'ts, but simply coming back to the centrality, which is Jesus Christ, the centrality of our lives as believers. And so Paul, one of the key verses here that I believe ties a lot of it together is Colossians chapter 1, verse 13. And he's really bringing to the point of Christ being everything in these passages of Scripture, that Christ is first place, not second, not third, but first in our lives. And he says, He has delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed us into the kingdom of the Son of his love, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. And he goes on to say how he's above everything, that all things through him were created, and before him nothing was created that was created. that he is the head of the body, which we are. If all of us are born again, if all of us have given our lives and we put our trust and our faith in what Jesus has done for us to bring us to the Father, then all of us are the body of Christ. Every one of us that has put that trust in Jesus and what he's done for us are that body. And so, as he goes on in Colossians chapter 2, we're going to be in Colossians chapter 3, but just coming up to it, Paul makes this point that it's not about philosophy. It's not about the ways of this world. And he says, "Beware lest anyone cheat you through philosophy and empty deceit, according to the tradition of men, according to the basic principles of the world, not according to Christ. For in him, in Christ, dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and you are complete in him, who is the head of all principality and power." So what he's saying is, in Christ, when Christ came to this earth, in him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. So the God that created everything, the stars, the moon, the heavens, everything in the world dwells in Christ. And now we as his creation are now complete in him, brought into completeness in Christ Jesus. And in that completeness in Christ, all principality and powers are below him. So in Christ we walk seated, as we'll see, with him in a new reality, new heaven. So I know this is, we'll keep going on. And so he goes on to say later on in chapter 2, and this is in verse 20. Talks about worship, false humility, and different things above it. Not false humility, but he talks about how our lives are seated with Christ in God. Now, actually, verse 12. But it says, "Buried with him in baptism, in which we were also raised with him through faith in the working of God, who raised him from the dead, and you being dead in your trespasses and sins, and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he has made alive together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses, having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us, which was contrary to us, and has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross. And having disarmed principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle over them, triumphing in it, in the cross." So in baptism, which we will do next week, I believe, next week we'll be doing baptism. So in baptism is not just a sign where we go into the water and we come up and we say it's just a part of our tenets to our faith, which it is part of our faith. It's an essential part of our faith. But it's actually recognizing with Christ's death on the cross that when he died to this world, when he died the death to sin, he was buried. And in that being buried, he buried the sins, the transgressions of every one of us that put our hope and trust in him. And he rose from the dead, and he was raised and seated at the right hand of the Father. So in baptism, we are then buried with him. We are saying to the world that we are dead. We are dead to this world. But in that death, we are now alive to God. And so our lives are alive to the King. And so when we are dead in trespasses, we couldn't save ourselves. Christ came and forgave us all our trespasses so we could be alive to him. So we'll go into chapter 3 here. It's kind of coming up to it. And we'll read chapter 3 from verse 1 all the way down to verse 11 to start with. And it says, "If you were raised with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is sitting at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on things on the earth. For you died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. Christ, who is our life, appears, you will also appear with him in glory. Therefore, put to death your members which are on the earth: fornication, uncleanness, passion, evil desire, covetousness, which is idolatry. Because of these things, the wrath of God is coming upon the sons of disobedience, in which you yourselves once walked when you lived in them. But now you are to put off all these things: wrath, anger, malice, blasphemy, filthy language out of your mouth. Do not lie to one another, since you have put off the old man with his deeds and put on the new man, who is renewed in knowledge according to the image of him who created him, where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcised nor uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave, nor free, but Christ is all and in all. And so going from chapter 3, verse 1 to verse 4, he's talking about a new humanity that we live in. So when we put our faith and trust in Christ, we are brought into new creation. We've heard it many times. For all things have passed away and all things become new. We are a new creation in Christ, which the old is gone and the new has come. And I think so often it just becomes this, we intellectualize it, saying, yeah, I'm a new creation. I'm in Christ. And it stays up here. It stays in our mind. And the reality of the new creation doesn't sink in our heart, and it doesn't affect the way we live our life. So what we do is we intellectualize it so often, and then we make lists or we make rules to our life on how to follow that new creation. So we know not to do this, and we know not to do that. We know to do this, and we know not to do this. You know, and so we kind of make this. We take what Christ is saying to us and we bring it to the earth, and we put it into our jobs, we put it into our families, and we put it into all these things instead of allowing Christ to come and bring us into all these things. Take us into our families, to take us into our jobs, to take us into our relationships and different things. Instead, I think so often we are the ones that go into these things, and then we say, Christ, would you come and be with me? I'm a new creation. I'm with you. You're with me. Come in and bless what I'm doing. I believe what God wants to do is he wants to, I believe the reality of the Christian faith is to kill us. Just being honest. I truly believe that the life of a Christian is that God wants us to die. Doesn't want us to live. That our life would no longer be our own. That we could be vessels that God could use. And so in order for us to do that, we have to realize where we are. We have to realize that this isn't an earthly way we think. This isn't a set of principles we follow. This isn't just simply an add-on to our life. This is our life. Christ is our life. And the reality of Christ, what he did for us, is to take us into the reality of who he is. And then from that place for him to take us into every area, in every sphere of life, so that his power and his life could flow through us, that others could experience his love, his kindness, his tenderness, his patience. When people revile us, we come back with blessings. That when Christ brings us into these places, he's the one that's living through us instead of the other way around. And so we'll read verse 1 to 3 again, or 1 to 4 in chapter 3. It says, if you then were raised with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is sitting at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on the earth. For you died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you will also appear with him in glory. So Paul's writing to the Colossians. He's writing. Same thing is true for us today, is that if we have died with Christ, if we have put our hope, our faith, our lives, and said, God, here I am, and that's what salvation is it's giving everything to Christ, repenting, turning, giving everything, and trusting in him. And if we have, then we are seated with him in the reality that is yet to come and that is here now. We are seated with him in the heavenly places in Christ. And in that place where Christ is seated at the right hand of God, we are seated with him in heaven, above every principality and power on this earth. And so when we walk this life, we set our minds up there. We set our minds on, God, what are you doing? Where are you at? Where are you at in my life? And we leave it there. And we allow his reality the way we live our life in this world. says in verse 3, for you died. And that means to deprive of power, destroy the strength of. So when we set our minds up there on the things above, when we set our minds on what Christ has done, when we set our minds on the fact that it's not our life no more, this is no longer our life, and we set our mind there and we say, here I am. Show me where I'm at. Show me what I'm doing, what you want me to do. Show me, just show me. And I think some of the greatest prayers is, Jesus, help me. And so whatever we give focus to, we give place to in our lives. So if we live a life that's looking, let me back up. I asked the Lord, I said, Lord, what do you have? What do you have for us? Because every one of us, God knows all of our hearts. I said, God, what do you have for us? And I really felt the Lord said, practical steps. Practical steps to living in the new man. Living a victorious life, not a beat up, hopeless, just tiresome life that we often so live. We live a life that we get there at the end of the day and we're just beat up. We have no more energy left. We're wondering, why am I doing this? Why am I, what's the point of this? Is my faith even, I believe in you, but I see no evidence of this life that I hear of from time to time, of this new life, this life full of joy, this life of peace, this life that says, Jesus, you're worthy of whatever you have for me to do, because you're worth it. And I think so often, that's the way our life is. And if that's the way our life is, that's not the life that God's called us to have. God's called us to have a life of victory, a life of abundance, a life that that takes on a whole new nature, to be metamorphosized into a whole new creation. Not the one that we see around us, but in a whole new life, we take on Christ's life. And so I feel like God was... I asked God, what do you have for us? And he said, he said a few times, practical steps to walk this life. But the realities of where we are, and then because we're seated there, because that's where we are with Christ, how are we to live this life? And every one of us is growing in this more and more. But how do we live this life? And so, whatever we give focus to in our lives, we give place to in our lives. And we're going to see that God, that Paul's going to call us to put off things of the flesh, our sins, things of the flesh, and he's going to have us put on things of the Spirit, of Christ, and to walk in this new humanity, to walk in this new life with Christ as the head. And so, so he tells us that when Christ, who is our life, appears, then we will also appear with him in glory. So where Christ lived on this earth as he walked in this life and as he was with the Father on this earth, when he is in complete communion with him, in the glory and the love that he experienced from the Father, that is the reality of our lives in Christ. A life that is full, is active, is vigorous, a life that has zeal, a life that has love for people that hate us. That's the life he calls us to. Not a life of mediocrity. Not a life of just going through the rhythms. Not a life of can't wait to get to heaven. But a life that says, you know what? I found something worth dying for. I'm not waiting to die and find that. I found it here. One day I will be there in the fullness. But I found something worth dying for. If we haven't found something worth living for, I don't forget that. But I mess up sometimes. I don't. But Christ didn't call us to live in mediocrity. He didn't call us to live in the course of this world. He called us to live differently, completely differently. And so he says in verse, we're going on to verse 5. So this is the practical steps he's going to give us, the what to do and what not to do. So he says, therefore, put to death your members which are on the earth, fornication, uncleanness, passion, evil desire, covetousness, which is idolatry. Covetousness, greed, money, mammon, evil desires, sensuality, all these things he's calling us to put off, put to death, deprive the power of, destroy the strength of. He's calling us to completely put it to death. Like, it's no longer a part of our life. It's no longer going back to it and saying, that's who I am. But he's wanting us to put it to death, to bury it. As we were buried with Christ in baptism, we were raised to newness of life. We were raised to a new life by the power of the Holy Spirit to live a life that represents our God, our Father. And he says, and why? Why does he tell us? He says, because of these things, the wrath of God is coming upon the sons of disobedience, in which you yourselves once walked when you lived in them. So Paul is saying, put off these things. But why? Why? Because the wrath of God is coming upon the sons of disobedience. It's the anger of God. It's us coming against everything that is good when we live in these things. We make ourselves an enemy of God, which is good. And we make ourselves enemies against everything that is good. So when we live in selfishness, which is sin, is selfishness, we put ourselves enemies against everything that's good. We make ourselves enemies against God. But Paul charges them and he says, in which you once walked. So the reality is, if you're in Christ, you're not there no more. And if that's where you're living, simply turn. Calling us all to turn. If that's where you're living, turn. Repent. And turn to Christ. Confess what we need to confess. Leave it there. And let it go. It's no longer our life. And the guilt of that sin, he says in 1 John 9, he says he frees us from the guilt of sin. Completely. It's gone. Confess. Heart broken. That's what I did. Confess. Boom. It's gone. No more. That's not the reality of our lives anymore as new creations. The reality of our lives as blood-bought children of God, walking as children, empowered by the Spirit of God, and we walk before our Father and our King every day, living in His power and His life. So let's go to Ephesians chapter 5, verse 3-7. We're going to see the same picture, but we're going to see him charging them to live differently. So Ephesians chapter 5, verse 3. And we'll read on down. Sometimes these words are big words: fornication, sexual immorality, sexual pleasure, sexual things. I mean, all these things, they're such big words and they confuse me. I think sometimes they confuse us that they're so archaic maybe at ways, but there's sexual immorality, sexual lust, sexual things, all these things is what he's talking about with fornication, uncleanness, sensuality, just desiring these things of the flesh, covetousness, greed, wanting more. So in verse 3 it says, but fornication and uncleanness or covetousness, let it not even be named among you, as he's writing to these Ephesians, as it is fitting for the saints. Neither filthiness nor foolish talking nor coarse jesting, which are not fitting, but rather giving thanks. For this you know, that no fornicator, unclean person, nor covetous man, who is an idolater, has any inheritance in the kingdom of God, of Christ, and of God. Let no one deceive you with empty words. Because of these things, the wrath of God is coming upon the sons of disobedience. Therefore, do not be partakers in them. So God is charging them, saying that's not fitting for us as saints. If we've been born again, and our faith and our life is truly put into God's hands, we've been made children of God, and we've been made saints of God. We've been made holy, not by us, but by Christ in us, through the power of His Spirit in us. And and he's saying, put away all these things because that's not fitting for us. And he tells them that if we live in those things, the inheritance of heaven will not be ours. But he charges them over and over and over in Corinthians, in Ephesians, in Colossians, and in many other places. Another place he tells them all these things, the same thing, and he says, but you are sanctified. But you are washed. You are sanctified. You are justified, just as if you never sinned. And that's what he tells us. In Christ, that's what we are. Just as if we never sinned. So the reality of our lives is not that. It's not just living in all these things. And if that's where we are, we simply turn to Christ, we repent, we turn to Christ, we confess, and allow our hearts to be broken. And I believe the more it goes on, it can happen like that. Sometimes it takes a while. But our reality of our lives, we have to put that stuff to death, because it's not who we are. We are God's children. We are co-heirs with Christ and heirs of God. The whole universe that God created, and he rules over the kings of this earth. He is our Father, and his Son now dwells in us. And so our lives are no longer our own, but they're Christ's. He lives through us. And so we'll go back to Colossians chapter 3. I hope you guys are tracking with me a little here. So he goes on. So the reality is that's not our life. That's not our life. We don't live in those things no more if we're seated with Christ in the heavenly places. And he goes on to say in verse 8, but now you yourselves are to put off these things. You're to renounce these things. You're to confess and put these away. All these things, anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy language out of your mouth. Do not lie to one another, since you have put off the old man with its deeds, and have put on the new man, who is renewed in knowledge according to the image of him who created him, where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcised nor uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, chain, slave or free, but Christ is all in it all. So we are to put off these things. We are to renounce them. We're to get rid of them out of our lives. But why? That's not who we are. And Christ, and Paul tells us in verse 10, he says, and put on the new man. Put on the new man created according to God, or who is renewed in knowledge according to God, to the image of him who created him. And Ephesians puts it this way, and that you put on the new man, which is created according to God in true righteousness and holiness. So our lives in Christ are a life of true righteousness and holiness. So we look at ourselves, we look in the mirror, we say, or we listen to ourselves, and we're like, wow, that doesn't seem like that's who I am. And I believe that's why Paul, over and over through his letters, continues to charge them of who they are, that they're not this and they're this. They're not this and they're this. To die to our old way of life and to put on the new man and to live in the reality that we are righteous before God, and righteous people act righteous, and that holy people walk in holiness. Because if we're sinners, we're going to constantly live in sin. We're going to say, I'm just a sinner. This is just who I am. This is just the way I've been called. And I find it interesting. But Jesus says, when you fast, and Paul, John says, if you sin. Which to us is, I think in many ways, pop up and go, that can't be true. But in Christ, there's no sin. And so our lives does not categorize by sinning. Our lives categorized by righteousness, righteous living, living righteously before God and before men. And the reality is when if things go down and something happens, we bring it before God, confess it, we walk away from it, no longer our lives. And our life is meant to be in a way that is lived out in the character and nature. not in the way we were, who I was. And so often we live there. We come here for a minute. We come in the new man. We come and we live in this place that is truly righteous and holy before God. And then we come over here and say, yeah, but I'm just a miserable sinner. I'm just a wretched sinner. And that we are. Because in my flesh dwells no good thing. But in Christ, I've been brought to completeness. You have been brought to completeness in Christ. It's no longer, that's not who we are. And we read before, he says, if all the fullness dwell in Christ, and you've been made complete in him, so each one of us are complete in Christ. That's no longer our lives. And I'll just read it here. You don't have to turn. But in Romans chapter 7, or verse, chapter 7, verse 18, living this life of sin, uses I don't know, 30 sometimes, I think, in Romans chapter 7. It just constantly, I. He kept looking to himself to make the difference in his life. And he kept saying he couldn't change it, couldn't do it. But he says in verse 18, he says, for I know that in me, that is in my flesh, nothing good dwells. In me, nothing good dwells. So Paul sees all these things that he's doing and he can't change. He wants to change, he can't change, and he's trying to change, and he's frustrated, and he's like, why do I do the things I don't want to do the things I do? I can't figure this out. And he says, I know inside of me no good dwells, and that is in my flesh. But he gets to the point towards the end, and he says, oh, wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So he got to the realization that who he was, that he cannot do it, that he's a sinner, that he's messed up, and that he needs a Savior. And Jesus is that Savior. And he says, what a wretched man that I am. He realizes that Jesus is the one that saves him. Romans chapter 8, we go into verse 9. It's the life of the Spirit, freed from the indwelling sin in our lives. And it says, but you are not in the flesh, in verse 9, but in the Spirit. If indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. Now, if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he is not his. And if Christ is in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. So our bodies are dead in Christ, our bodies are dead, and the Spirit of God in us through the Holy Spirit gives life to these mortal bodies, because now we, because of his righteousness in our lives. So we, in our flesh dwells no good thing, but in Christ we've been brought to completeness. We are not in the flesh, but we are in the Spirit. And so we live this life. So we put to death all these things, and we put on true righteousness and holiness. So we live a life that is a life that honors God, that honors one another. And we go on to see in verse 12, is therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, put on tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, long-suffering, bearing with one another and forgiving one another, if anyone has a complaint against another. Even as Christ forgave you, so you also must do. But above all these things, put on love, which is the bond of perfection. And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which also you were called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, in wisdom, teaching, admonishing one another, in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. So Paul goes on to say, therefore, because of all these things, as the elect of God, as the chosen of God, as we are chosen and elect, we are holy and we are dearly loved. So in Christ, we are holy and we are dearly loved. We aren't wretched, miserable sinners anymore. Christ has adopted us and brought us into his family. God has brought us into his family, adopted us as sons and daughters of the King. And he's made us holy and blameless. He's made us pure. He's made us spotless. So we can stand before God in confidence, and we can walk this life in boldness. Boldness to love. Boldness to speak the truth in love. Boldness to walk as sons and daughters of God. And he says to put on tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, long-suffering, bearing with one another and forgiving one another. And if any one of us has a complaint against another, that we are to forgive as Christ forgave us. And he goes on to say, but above all these things, put on love, which is the bond of perfection. So our lives are meant to be categorized by love. By love for God, ultimately. And from that place, love for our neighbor, love for our brothers and sisters, to come together, to encourage one another, to allow his word to dwell in us richly, so we can encourage, we can admonish, we can teach one another, that we could grow together in a family of God, not just a bunch of members outside doing their own thing, but a family, a living organism, a new humanity where righteousness dwells, where righteous living dwells. That we once were this way, not no more. It's not our life no more. No more. That's dead. That's gone. That's buried. We've been raised to new life. We've been raised to a new standard, a new reality, a new creation. We've been brought into the family of God, where Christ is the head and we are the children. We become slaves of righteousness. We become where righteousness is our go-to. No longer we stumble in it, or we kind of do haphazardly do things, and sometimes we make it, sometimes we don't. Our lives are categorized by victory, and it's not by our doing. It's by Christ in us living this new life through us, because we have died to the ways of this world. We've died to the principles of this world, the philosophy, always trying to find hidden knowledge everywhere, trying to find all these things that try to make our life better. Christ has already fulfilled that in our lives. We simply behold him. We simply look to him. We look to his character, his nature, his compassion, his tenderness. That's who we were. But now we should be this humanity that walks in complete kindness, gentleness, patience with people that don't deserve it, because we don't either. But God says, yeah, but I paid the price for you so that you can be wholly mine and walk as these children. Walk this new life where when somebody rebukes us or somebody yells at us, we repay with blessing. We repay with kindness. We come back and we pray for them. You know, whatever the Lord leads us to, but it's always a life of love, sacrificial love. And if it's not sacrificial, we have to ask, is it truly love? Because our old man, we would give to get something back because it'd make us feel good. Or we would help somebody out because we would put a check and it would make us feel righteous. So we feel like we did the right thing. But in Christ, we simply look to the King and how he lived his life. And we simply say, Lord, is it your timing? Lord, what's your next step for me? Where am I to go? Help me to show that love. Help me to value every person that I meet above myself. That everybody around me is superior to me. Help me to live a life that puts everybody else first, that puts you supremacy in my heart, in my life, that puts everybody else first above me. And I know Pastor John has said this many times. He says, if I have one looking out for me, that's something. But if I have 99 looking out for me, and that's what we are as the body of Christ. We come out, we love one another, we cover one another's mistakes, not to excuse them, but to cover them, to allow the Holy Spirit to do the work in all of our lives to bring us closer. Because what's going on that we see around us, this world's getting darker, but I see the children of God. We as the family of God are starting to see and shine bright in this world. And God God's calling us all to a new standard in life. He's not calling us to live that life anymore. That's not our life. It's dead. It's gone. No more. The new life is a life, as Paul said, of tenderness, of kindness, of humility, of meekness, of long-suffering. Long. It could be years. It could be years and years and years of long suffering with people. Because that's what he did for us. And that's what he's doing for us in ourselves. He's long suffering with each one of us here. So he calls us to put on that same nature, that same character, and live long suffering to one another. And I'm so thankful for that, because so often, you know, I've been that person that I needed to be long suffering with. And I'm so thankful that I have brothers and sisters out there in Christ that look to me and they see Christ in me. They don't see me who I was, they see who I am. And they love me. And they care for me. And they show kindness when I didn't deserve it. They show mercy when I didn't deserve it. And it did something to me. As Paul says, it's the goodness of God that leads us to repentance. It's not telling us all our wrongs. It's showing goodness and it's showing kindness that God has shown to us to bring us to Him. So our lives are new. A.W. Tozer puts it this way in a quote of salvation. So now when we walk this life, so we're a new creation. We walk this life, it doesn't just happen. It doesn't just come on. Paul said we got to put off, we got to put on. There's effort involved. Salvation, our salvation from Christ has been wrought on the cross. Extinction, complete extinction upon the cross wrought the extinction of our former nature, our former corruption. By the death of Christ upon the cross, we have been utterly estranged from, dead to, our former habits of feeling and action. That's the lexicon for the word crucified. As Paul said, I've been crucified with Christ, no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. The life that I now live in the flesh, I live by faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me and for you in your lives as you put your hope and trust in him. So that's our life. So we got these practical things that God or Paul's calling us to live in. But what does that look like? It takes effort. And A.W. Tozer puts it this way. He says, salvation apart from obedience. So now our life is categorized now that this is our life and we're growing into it. A.W. Tozer, in his quote, gives us this charge. He says, salvation apart from obedience is unknown in sacred scripture. Apart from obedience, there can be no salvation. For salvation without obedience is a self-contradictory impossibility. So, similar to the fact that faith without works is dead, show me your faith by your works, and I will show you my works by my faith. Having faith, we've been saved. So now from that place, because of our faith and believing it and walking in it, we live out the works God calls us to. So our lives are obedient. We have to be obedient. We get to, and we have to. As born-again believers, we get to, and we have to. That's grace. That's our life of love for the King, for Jesus. And he goes on to say in another place, so the final test of the love is obedience. Not sweet emotions, not willingness to sacrifice, not zeal, but obedience to the commandments of Christ. And I know so often in my life, as I'm growing and as I'm learning and as I'm walking with God, there's times that I just go sacrifice. Sometimes I'm just very zealous and I'm of the things of God. And God over and over and over again has been gracious and kind to me and continue to bring me back to that place. A closer, tighter walk with him where it's not about sacrificing but obedience. As Samuel told Saul in the Old Testament, he says, to obey is better than sacrifice. To put our lives on the altar that God never called us to, but he called us to obey him. In his commandments, he obeyed us to obey him in love, to love our neighbor as ourselves. So he calls us to be obedient, to walk in this obedience. And as Athanasius says, Jesus became what we are, that we might become what he is. So everything that Jesus is, we become. And Athanasius was an early church father in the second 200, 300. But we have a part to play. Our life is obedient. We get to be obedient. We have to be obedient to the commandments of Christ, to walk in this new man, and to live this life. In the beginning of Colossians, he says, the love in the Spirit. It wasn't love in the flesh. He's talking to the Colossians. Epaphras came back and told him his love for them in the Spirit. So there's a love that comes from the depth of our soul and our life that we have with one another. And as we come together, we're to encourage, we're to love one another, we're really to show God to one another in life. And we as the body of Christ all have different functions. But in Christ, we're all his. So in 1 Peter, this is a beautiful promise that we have as we live this life. 1 Peter chapter 3. This is a great promise that he has for us. In 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 8. If I'm not mistaken, in Peter's time, this was a lot of persecution. A lot of persecution was going on in their time. And he says in 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 8, he says, finally, all of you be of one mind, having compassion for one another. Love as brothers. Be tender-hearted. Be courteous. Not reviling evil for evil or reviling for reviling. But on the contrary, blessing, knowing that you were called to this, that you may inherit a blessing. For he who would love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayers. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. So he tells them, right after he got done speaking to husbands and wives, he says, finally, all of you be of one mind, having compassion for one another, love as brothers, be tender-hearted, be courteous, not returning evil for evil or reviling for reviling, but on the contrary, blessing, knowing that you are called to this, that you may inherit the blessing. And every one of us wants, I believe, every one of us wants a good life. Every one of us wants to see good days in our life. And that good life is putting on the character and the nature of the new man, which is Christ that lives in us, dwells in us, and lives through us. That this world that's out there can see something different than backstabbing and lying and contentions and coming against one another. That they can see a new people, a new humanity, Christ followers that walk out there in love, showing compassion, showing kindness, no matter the situation. And all of us can encourage one another to walk in this. And when we allow Christ to dwell in our hearts richly through his word, through teaching, through different things, we can come together as the body of Christ and grow in the Spirit, in the inner man. We can grow where we leave, and Christ is the one that strengthens us. So it's not a life that is apart from the body of Christ, but a part that's with the body of Christ and with Christ at the centrality of our lives. Bible talks a lot about coming together as the body of Christ. And in the New Testament, or in the book of Acts, it talks about meeting together daily. They met, apostles' doctrine, breaking of bread, prayers, fellowship. They would just come together. And it's not that we can't talk about business, we can't talk about the things, hobbies, we can't talk about all these things. That's not the point. But I think if that's the root of our lives, we're not living in Christ. If the root of our lives is that, then we have to take that to God and we have to repent and tell God that, tell him where we're struggling. He is gracious, he is merciful, he's compassionate, and he will forgive, and he will give a power, he will empower us to live this life he's called us to. It's impossible. But in him, it's possible. So if the root of our lives is all these things of this world, and when we come together and that's the root, we've missed it. That we've missed it. Our lives are not categorized by our outside. Our lives are categorized by inside, reflecting on the outside what's going on in the inside. It's inside, outside, not outside to get in. We don't do things to get closer to God. We come before God humbly, recognition of who we are, and we allow him to change us from the inside out, that we, as Paul said, he said, for by the grace of God I am what I am, and his grace towards me was not in vain, but I labored more abundantly than them all, yet not I, but the grace of God that was in me. So it was God's grace, it was his working of his God's Spirit in Paul that allowed him to work more abundantly than the rest of them. So if our lives are categorized by this world, we need to bring that to God. We truly need to be broken for it. And allow God's life to purify us and allow us to live the good life that he's called us to in Christ, no matter what it looks like. No matter where he sends us, no matter what he calls us to, it's worth it. He's worth it. Not what we need to get from him. He's worthy. And he's worth it all. No matter what our lives look like. Pain, but struggle, and its victory. He's worthy of it all. He's worthy of all our lives. He's worthy of all our hearts, of everything in our lives. And we need to bring all of our lives to him and say, here I am. Here's my life. Here's my business. Here's my family. Here's my hobbies. Here's everything that I've put my time into. And I've left you on the back burner. I give it to you. I turn from those things today. My heart's broken over them. I look see, and I have not followed you. I've not looked to you. I've not looked to you for my sustenance. And I've become frustrated in life. I've become angry. I've become just bitter towards so many people. We need to bring those things to God. We need to allow him to break, to show us those things first and foremost in our lives. And then from that place, just to give them to him. So this is who I am. This is what I've done. And instantly, we're resolved in it. And we just live the new man. We forget it completely. Don't live there. It's not our life. We're not called to live there. We're called to be obedient. We're called to live a life that's worthy of Christ dying for us. As Christ died for us so that not only can we live with him here, get to know him here, have intimate fellowship with him here, be with him in heaven, live with him forever. So, next week, as we go into baptism, I think there's a great passage of scripture, is to take this new life that those who will, I don't know who will be getting baptized, but I'm very thankful for you making that step as the Lord guided you into that. Verse 2 and 3, Romans chapter 6, we'll read verse 1, and we'll just read down, I think. Verse 4, it says, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Certainly not. How shall we who died to sin live any longer in it? Or do you not know that as many as were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we were buried with him through baptism into death, and just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we should walk in newness of life. For if we've been united together in the likeness of his death, we certainly shall be in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old man was crucified, that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves of sin, for he who has died has been freed from sin. Now if we died with Christ, we believe we should also live with him. He goes on to say, consider that to be your life. His death is now our death through baptism, but now his life that he walk this freedom, this liberty as children, as sons, as daughters of God, to allow the lost and dying world to see the reflection of God and the image of God upon our lives, so that they could see it. We need each other, each one of us, to come together to encourage each other in the Word, to allow this to be the root of our lives, that we would grow together as one body, that no matter where we go in the world, we can still have that same fellowship, that same communion with one another, because the same God lives in us and is the centrality of our lives. So we get to come together, encourage, admonish, have our lives rooted in the Word, live this life. And I love the passage where Jesus says, to the lady caught in adultery, he says, who condemns you? And he says, no one, Lord. She acknowledged him as Lord. And he says, go, sin no more. He tells her, he says, go and sin no more. Don't sin no more. And he says later on, he says, he who follows me shall never sin, never walk in darkness, never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. When we follow Jesus, our life is not categorized by darkness or sin. Our life is categorized by victory, of righteousness, of holiness. If anything ever comes up, we bring it immediately before the Father, and we put it to death, and we forget all about it. And we walk pure before our God and Father as we live in Christ, His life hope through us, that we can be the body and be representation of Him on this earth, and live in the new humanity that He's called us to, the new man. Let's end in prayer. Father, I'm so thankful of what you did through your Son on that cross, that you wrought the death of our former corruptions, the life that and the body that was subject to sin and death, you put it to death, burying it, that in the resurrection we too arise with Him. We thank you for the resurrection life that you've given to us through your Son, that we no longer live in the old man, that we put the old man to death. We live in the new man, created according to God in true righteousness and holiness. That we walk as children, as lights in this lost and broken world, this corrupt world. Lord, I thank you for taking your life and giving it to us to live your life through here, Lord, through us on this earth. Lord, help us to live this life. Help us daily to put to death the things of the flesh and to keep our focus on you, to look to you, to live a good life with you no matter the circumstances, to live in peace and joy as you live your life through us. We live in intimate communion with you, Father. That you would help us live this life and help one another, all of us, to come together to encourage, press on, and to live this life of love, sacrifice, blessing, to live a life with you. That we would grow together in this as a family, as the body of Christ globally, that we would be of one mind, of one heart, and we strive together for the faith of the gospel. Bring this everywhere where you send us, our families to our jobs, that we would be your light that reproves all darkness around us. We thank you for the privilege to be your sons and daughters, live as your children, you as our Father, no matter the circumstances. I ask a blessing on everyone here and all those that are watching. Of Allie and Kurt, as they got married last night, Lord, we just ask a special blessing on all those that attended, and those as they go forth on their journey, Lord, that your blessing would be upon them richly, that you keep their eyes on you, that you could continue to give them that heart of obedience that says whatever, whenever, and however. And Lord, I just thank you for bringing them two together. Bring them into the family as they go out to Washington, that you bring them into a great family, your family, your body, extension of this one, Lord. You bring them all together as you as dead.